This is Merryn Jose, and you are listening to MerlianNewsPodcast.com. Jodi Serota is a life-changing metaphysical educator, channel, vibrational healer, and professional artist. Her remarkable sound healing powers are used to create activations and initiations which instantly make major shifts in consciousness and healing. She is co-author of the book Healing the Heart of the World, from Elite Books, and is the owner and creator of the Meta Center, New York. Welcome to the show, Jodi.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's a pleasure. Now, for my first question, what is the main intention of your work as a channel?
My work is really all about consciousness raising and healing and personal growth, transformation, and creativity. So everything that I do seems to come under that umbrella.
Mm.
And I've been doing my work for many years, for over 25 years, and through all the different work that I've done on myself, all the work that I do with everyone else, I actually do on myself and have been for all this time and have continued. And as I've been doing that, more and more of my own gifts have been coming through. So my work, I do, my background is actually painting. I have a background in fine arts as a painter.
Yes.
Went to school for that. And
when did all this channeling and
the other work, actually, I've always been interested in mediumship and I always had an interest in death, like what happens after you die. So when I was a kid, I used to read books on anything to do with any of those things, not knowing that I was actually going to turn out to be doing this work, but it was just an interest of mine. And I've always been intuitive, but I think it was something natural and I didn't know any differently, you know, that other people weren't seeing or feeling the same things that I was.
Mm. What about your parents? Did they encourage you in this, or did you keep it a secret?
No, I actually, luckily I've had a very supportive background in this lifetime where I was always encouraged, especially in my art, and then when I was doing other things, they weren't quite sure what to make of all of it, but eventually they were having me doing healings on them and open to all of it just because they trusted in me. So I was encouraged in doing everything that I do, which was very beneficial to me because it helped me to feel good about just having the opportunity to allow myself to even go in the directions that I felt.
Yes, and when did you become professional in this?
Probably in my 20s. I started to really focus on all of this. I started to really go into meditation, and when I was in college, I started doing transcendental meditation, but at the time, it was more of a fad, more of something to do, and it was interesting to me, but I didn't really come into my full spirituality until probably after college. And then everything just happened very quickly for me. It took over a period of time to kind of really come into all of that I'm doing. But as I started to meditate, I took a course with someone who had a psychic development course. Just in the moment, the first thing we did was go into a meditation and try to get some information by tuning into ourselves. And I started getting information from guides and writing out all this information. So I was already open, but I don't know if I realized it to the level that I was.
Yes, you were ready.
And then it sort of took a turn to kind of work into myself and work through all different things that would come up. So I would study a little bit of healing, Reiki healing, and that kind of thing, just to open my channel more for me to just do it for myself, but not thinking I was going to be doing it for others. And it gradually it all kind of evolved, but very quickly. And I realized I had very quickly after that a sense of a purpose or a mission to do something that related to being of service in relation to a much larger picture.
Yes.
And through the process, I realized that in order for me, a big part that came up for me was that I was supposed to be speaking in front of large audiences for the purpose of consciousness raising and healing and all the things that I had mentioned before.
Mm-hmm.
In order for me to do that, I had to really work on myself to clear a lot of energetic charges from other lifetimes where I had been killed for doing this work or tortured or something of that nature.
Yes.
So I worked through a lot of that, all of those things, and because I had such a strong passion for the purpose to be of service to God.
Mm.
And when I grew up, I didn't even know if I believed in God, and I was brought up Jewish but very non-religious. And through this process, it turns out all of my work now is about the whole higher understanding or orchestration, which I perceive as God or love.
That's wonderful, Jodi. And I see that you're a co-author of the book Healing the Heart of the World, Harnessing the Power of Intention to Change Your Life and Your Planet. And I believe that was published last year in 2005. And also, it's been voted Most Inspirational Book of the Year for the Independent Publishers Association.
Yeah, it was great. I was actually asked to be part of this book. Mm. It's co-authored with about 40 different authors, and many of the people in this book are pretty well-known in the field. And in other fields, we have people like Carolyn Mace, Thich Nhat Hanh, Andrew Harvey, Dean Ornish, Dr. Emoto, even Prince Charles is in this book. We all have different, there's a lot of different people. It's a really interesting book. Great gift idea, because it's sort of, it's all about healing the heart of the world, so it's all about bringing everyone together.
Oh.
And it's also, it's really about the power of intention to change your life and the planet. So it's great because it's an easy read. You can pick different chapters to read from different people's perspectives from all the different places that they're coming from.
Oh, that's wonderful.
But the intention is all about really that we all are here together and how are we all going to make this work.
Mm. And your chapter is called The Frequency of Love. Can you tell us about that and how it relates to your work?
Yeah, a lot of my work, I've sort of over the years, I've done a lot of different things, but it always feels like the end result is we're trying to understand oneness and love. Mm-hmm. And I'm a vibrational healer. I do a lot of work through my art as visual vibration as much as I work with sound through my voice from other dimensions that affects your whole consciousness with audible vibration. I also do concerts and things where I combine the art and the sound and then guided information and journeying, and sometimes I add musicians and lighting and create mm-hmm. environments that have to do with all of this. But the actual book, though, my focus, I decided to write about the frequency of love because I think of love as an all-inclusive frequency. I think of everything in terms of vibration and frequency.
Yes.
So we're here to understand, I believe, that we are that which we're looking for, which is love, and that's the glue that holds everything together.
Mm.
So it's all-inclusive. There are no conditions when people say they're sick, they're in a state of dis-ease or and not being at ease with something, they usually say, I have this condition.
Yes.
So it's like a condition placed upon them somehow where it's taken them from a placement of perceiving themselves as something as pure as love, which I kind of equate with the idea of the God consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
So the focus, what I did is I talked about the idea that we're in a whole structure of consciousness, and in that structure, the glue that holds everything together is love. And that's what brings everything together. When you feel love, when you feel love for someone else, or you're being loved or feeling lovable, it just helps you to feel whole within yourself and connected to everything else.
Yes, and this sounds like a must read for everyone.
Thank you. The other part of that is I wrote it in relation to my chapter about love, in relation to walking a labyrinth. Because I do labyrinth events. I have a 36-foot labyrinth that I do big events at the end of the year, usually at St. John the Divine, at that church. And I work with live music, live Indian music, and we have a lot of fun because it's the end of the year, festive kind of experience.
Yes.
But it's walking a labyrinth also has a whole thing of balancing out all the different sides of your brain, the two sides of the brain. It brings you into an internal place. It represents, it's a pattern that you walk through that's on canvas.
Mm.
And it's similar to a maze, but without walls.
Yes.
And the idea is that it has a pattern that it's a universal path. There's no place to get stuck in there, one path.
Hmm.
With a maze, there's usually different paths, and you get stuck and have to logically figure out how to get out.
Hmm.
In a labyrinth, there's one path. You go all the way into the center. The center represents your connection with yourself and your God connection.
Mm.
And you can go in with questions and have them answered and then walk back out. It represents your life, all the twists and turns in your life, but no matter where you are on the path, you can always see your center or be centered because there's no walls except in our perceptions.
Goodness, that sounds so interesting. I
sort of connected it with the idea that love is also an all-inclusive thing. There's no separation.
And how large did you say this labyrinth was?
Well, my labyrinth, I had it made so I can do things with large groups. It's 36 feet, so it's a big round thing, although I had it even sectioned off into a dodecahedron, a 12-sided figure, which adds in a whole sacred geometric point of view. So there's all this, I talk about the numerology and the sacred geometry and all the different elements and things that relate to labyrinths. So in the book, I just kind of related it to the idea of going through your life with all the different things that happen. And no matter what happens, we're still always able to bring ourselves into that resonance of of our perception of ourselves as, of our understanding of ourselves as God or love. And when you feel loved, you feel, or loving, you feel connected. You don't, you usually don't feel disconnected because it's an energy that kind of goes towards something.
Yes.
And in general, when I talk about vibration in my work, a lot of people have issues. I do a lot of individual sessions, private channeled readings and healing work. Mm. A big thing that people ask about, other than their sense of purpose, is they want to understand who they are in relation to everything. All of these things seem to interconnect, the things that I do, to help you to connect first to yourself and then to feel a connection to everything else.
Yes, that's what I was going to ask, is how do you work with all these modalities in relation to consciousness raising and healing?
Well, everything that I do has evolved, and I find that one thing, I feel lucky because I'm able to, at this point, do the things that I really love to do. And when I think of personal, when people ask me about purpose, first of all, I always think of, there's two different forms of purpose. One is personal purpose, what your soul came here to evolve through on a personal level, doing your personal growth work. Mm-hmm. If you clear, if you get yourself clear about your own issues and things that you came in with to really clear, your outer purpose, to be of service to the greater whole, seems to unfold naturally.
Yes.
And then if you, at that point, if you can do what you love to do, your passion, you actually are completely in alignment with yourself and everything that exists for the greater whole.
Yes.
So what I do is I work with all different things. I'm an artist, I'm a painter. I'm also, so that's, I work with visual vibration. I work with sound through my voice that came through as I was doing healing on myself many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
The sound has become a really huge tool for me to work with, and it goes, cuts right through to everything. Because you can either, even if you're not sure what it's doing, for most people, they hear it, they can feel it. Some people can see colors in relation to it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just something so tangible. So I work with my metaphysical teachings, always going to the underlying cause of what's going on with people, to understand from all different time frames and dimensions, what's the truth behind everything? What's the illusion and what's the truth?
Yes.
And so I work with guided information that comes through me. I also work with vibrational sound that goes right into the DNA of your cells, where your consciousness actually emanates from the DNA of our cells. So it actually activates it and helps you to pretty much remember who you already are.
Mm.
So you're not really broken and need to be fixed. You're just remembering the truth of who we already are. And the sound seems to help to move things or shift. There's been tests through a doctor, Hans Jenny, who's not alive anymore, but he, many years ago, had done all these tests of sound on matter.
Yes.
He would put sand on a plate.
Yes.
And then they, through microscopes, they would measure how, when you put sound into the room and directing it toward this, the sand would go into all these different shapes and patterns.
Mm.
And when they'd add more sound or overtones, they did this with computers at the time, they would find that everything would keep going into the same shapes. And if you change the sounds, it would go into different patterns.
Mm.
So they found that you can use this on any form of matter. So I do this intuitively. I was doing this before I knew about that, but I was doing this intuitively that would affect your cells. So if somebody has, it could be anything from a cancerous growth to a headache, or, you know, it could just be anything to do with anything related to the issues related to it, the physical, tangible parts of your body.
Mm.
So it works physically, emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. So I work with sound, I work with color, I work with my art.
Yes.
I work with guided information and with labyrinths. I also work with crystals, ancient crystal skulls, which is a whole other thing.
Oh, my goodness.
That's an those are all different activations and
yes.
things. But all of these things are under the same umbrella of the consciousness raising and healing and creativity and personal growth. And through doing all of this work, I create these environments where people are activated and stimulated so their senses can be heightened, so they can basically live their lives consciously, but from a higher conscious perspective.
That's so interesting. And I believe you've recently, well, last year, I think it is, opened the Meta Center in New York. Can you tell us about its mission and how it came to be?
Sure. That actually, I finally opened up a center. I've been renting spaces for so many years and just wanted to have an environment that was really pure in its intention and specifically for metaphysical education. So I had had a vision. My guides came to me over 20 years ago and said to me, one day you're going to open up a center in New York, and that it had to be in New York because it's a hub for places all over the world. and that it would start as one thing and grow into something much larger, so that it would be big enough that people would hear about it and go to see this place and be there from all over the place. And they told me that I should wait till I'm established enough in this area to be able to even do this, so that it would be a lot easier for me to be able to do this. And it turned out in the last year I kind of got the feeling that I needed to come into this now, and that it was necessary and needed at the time on the planet when people are really going through some major changes.
Of course.
But the focus of it would be, they told me that it would be, again, about what I had talked about before, the consciousness raising and healing, personal growth and creativity, and that it should be something that's not just holistic but also metaphysical, so that it would include even the work that I do, because I used to go to places to try to be there, and I would be a little bit too out there for them. To create a space that would be for metaphysical education, for healing, for anything to do with the arts, any form of the arts, whether it's film, whether it's painting, whether it's art, fine arts, whether it's music, sound, all of these kinds of things, and also anything to do with scientific research on vibrational medicine. And that I should start something in New York that would grow into something much larger, and eventually it would also have a cafe. That was the other part of it. But the other part of it was that it would become something that eventually they would tell me where to have these in other countries, but only one major one in different countries, so we can have cross-teachings, cross-referencing of world teachings, otherworldly teachings, so that when you went into these spaces, you'd have multi-world experiences. And that it would be something that would bring all of community together back to that same intention about the idea of love. That would create that frequency. And that what I did is I made it a center that was more refined, a little bit more upscale. Because in terms of my own artistic abilities and just what I like and like to be around in terms of the aesthetics, I wanted to have it be aesthetically pleasing.
Well, I actually have been there, and it is aesthetically pleasing. It's a very beautiful space.
Thank you. And also, it's feng shuied, so it's got all that energetic alignment. I have energetic grids placed in the whole place there that I do with my channeling, so that it's always consistently cleansed and purified. We have people take off their shoes, so we keep it as a sacred space.
Wonderful.
So I have it for my work, and we rent out space for other people, and we send out calendars of events for people. So it really has been really bringing people together. And the international part of it has really come together without us even having the other spaces. People from all over the world have been coming, which is really amazing, just through word of mouth.
Oh, yes.
And one other thing, just really quickly, is that I was trying to come up with a name. And I was going through this whole thing, and I said, what should I name it? And they just said, like I said, Meta Center New York, because there'll be like a Meta Center Paris or a Meta Center wherever. And that the meta means beyond, like metaphysical,
beyond
the physical.
Yes.
Meta is a Sanskrit word that also means love.
Oh, I
and also that meta is, in this case, would be Multidimensional Education and Transformational Arts Center.
Oh, so a lot went into this.
So it was all perfectly organized, and they had it all set up, and I just said, okay, I'll do it.
Oh, Jodi, I want to thank you so much for being on the show today. I do hope you'll come back and keep us updated on all the things you're doing.
I would love to. Thank you so much for having me.
Oh,
I appreciate
pleasure.
It. Thanks for all your work.
Thank you. So for more information on Jodi Serota, which is spelled Jodi Serota, or the Meta Center, which as you've just heard is META, visit www.jodiserota.com. For Meta Center events, be sure to look for them on www.merliannews.com. This is Merryn Jose, and thank you.